Hi, welcome to Microsoft Virtual Academy. This is the session on software development fundamentals. We are heading into module 7, where we're going to get really practical with you. My name is Paul Party. I'm a content development lead, and I'm here with one of my direct reports, Jerry.
Hey, thanks, Paul. And yeah, welcome everybody to module 7, which for the software development fundamentals jumpstart is our final module. And this one we've called, Is This For Me? And as we take a look at the name of that one, if you haven't attended any of the previous modules, then it probably doesn't make sense to you as to why we're asking that question. The reason we're posing this one is because what we want to do is kind of give you the opportunity to reflect on the entire jumpstart, look at what you've seen so far, and decide if software development is something that you want to pursue as a career. Again, you know, I wanted to reiterate a little bit as we take a look at what we've covered over the previous 6 modules. We are focusing on trying to help you understand what you need to know to get into software development, and specifically this one is focused on our Microsoft Technology Associate Exam, so MTA Exam 98-361, which is Software Development Fundamentals. If you have an interest in taking it, if you're going to be attending school and it becomes a part of your curriculum at that school, where this becomes one of the classes that you might take, this gives you, this whole jumpstart will give you a kind of a really good high-level overview of what you can expect to learn in the classes that prepare you for that certification, and what you really, what you need to know at a core foundational level to start developing software applications. So, you know, we've covered some very core fundamental concepts here that are important that every developer needs to know. We haven't gone incredibly deep on each and every concept that we've covered, but this is, again, designed to be introductory material to not scare you off, but you know, kind of generate interest. So that's why this question, is this for me? Based on everything that we've covered from modules 1 right through to module 6 to here, we want you to be able to answer this question for yourself. And maybe to kind of help you a little bit, we've kind of brought up, you know, 3 final bullet points that we want to focus on. And you know, we want to talk about the day in the life of a software developer. It's all well and good to look at the content we've presented here and to say, hey, this is kind of neat. Yeah, I've looked at some of that stuff and I think I can do it. You know, technically I should be, knowledgeable enough to step into this, and I understood kind of some of the stuff that you focused on in here. But it still doesn't tell you what you can expect to encounter on a day-to-day basis sitting at a desk in front of a computer writing code as your career as a software developer. So we want to talk a little bit about what you can expect to encounter when you get employed out in the industry. Notice I didn't say if, I said when you get employed in the industry. So, and we'll talk a little bit about the types of opportunities that are available as well, so we'll cover that kind of in the same vein as what you can expect on a day-to-day basis. And then we'll close out with some links and some pointers on how do you get there from here. So how do you become a software developer? How do you start looking at resources that will help you prepare more for the exam, help you prepare more for what you need to do in software development, and to get your skills ramped up and learn a little bit more. I'm a firm believer of one thing, and that's never stop learning. If I used to tell my son, he's 20 years old, currently in college right now, pursuing a degree in aerospace engineering, and I tell him flat out, if you have a day that goes by that you haven't learned something new, you consider that a wasted day. Try better the next day. So seriously, just constantly learn. Take a look at the links that we have at the end of this. Drive yourself forward. Learn more, and never stop that passion for trying to get to where you want to be. That's what drives you. That's what gets you there. So taking a look at the day in the life of a software developer. Really, when we focus on this, it's, you know, what is it like to be a software developer for a career, or maybe what is it like to call yourself a software developer even as a hobbyist? As an example, for myself, my day-to-day job here in our learning experiences team at Microsoft, I focus on developing training and working with others who develop and write content for training, these MVA jumpstarts, working with people to put these together from an educational perspective to teach folks who want to learn the technology all of the ins and outs of it. So we develop training content, we develop all kinds of sessions and different ways of form factors for you to learn the material. But I do software development now as a hobby. I used to be a software developer and a consultant on a full-time basis. I used to sit, you know, at a desk all day long and punched out code and different things like that. And, you know, now I'm more focused on trying to help those of you who want to learn how to get there. You know, I've learned kind of the hard way. I've learned everything on my own, as opposed to attending schools to get, you know, university degrees and things in programming. So I try to make things a little bit easier for you from that perspective. But I also have sat in that chair as a software developer and taken a look at what programmers need to do, what the daily basis, what it looks like, you know, to do that. And it's not always sitting down in front of the computer and just writing code all day long. In, you know, the earlier modules, we talked about dealing with the application software development lifecycle and focusing on application specifications, writing technical specifications. So you might find that as a software developer in the industry, you might only spend 30% of a day writing code, and the rest of it is all focused around talking to the architects or talking to testers or talking to database administrators about what it is that you need to do. So software development is not a sit at home in your parents' basement in your pajamas developing code kind of an endeavor. Certainly there are lots of folks who do that, and there's nothing wrong with it. If that's what you want to do, go ahead, and you know, you can still be productive and you can, you know, create the next great Windows Phone application that way. But if you're working in the corporate environment and that's where you're going to be focusing on your development efforts, know that there's going to be interaction with other folks on the team, and you know, you'll be dealing with code, you'll be dealing with documentation, you'll be dealing with all kinds of issues and stuff. And you might even have to go through the process of setting up your own systems and your own test servers, so there's an understanding of computer software and hardware just to get to that point. And you know, Paul, you've done some software development in the past. Anything you want to add on that?
Well, the thing that comes to mind is just a quick anecdote about my first software development job. So prior to getting a job in an actual corporation, I had done a lot of volunteer work, which I actually recommend. It's a great way to get your feet wet, to try out some things. Volunteer opportunities are legion. There's a lot out there. So it's a good way to test your skills and work with other developers that are doing that same kind of work. But before I'd gotten into an actual corporation to work, I'd done a lot of volunteer work and then decided to go back to graduate school to get an MA. And I drop my new baby and wife off at her parents' house, and I go down to the school to start canvassing for work. And all I had under my belt was just some volunteer work in the computer industry. So I found a job that looked kind of interesting, and I had been looking for a couple months. I couldn't find anything. And so I remember picking up the phone and calling this one organization, and I kind of explained what my background was, and the guy on the other end of the phone said, well, you just don't really have the experience, so I think I'll pass. I said, I'll tell you what, I'll work for 2 weeks for free, and if I can't pull it off, then you can let me go. I'll walk away, and there's no obligation. And there was silence on the other end. He says, okay, show up on Monday and we'll see what you can do. So I wouldn't recommend taking that approach, but you know, the volunteer work actually got me some opportunities that I don't think I would have had otherwise, and I learned a ton by working in those circumstances. So that might be a great place for people to start.
Yeah, and so great insight on that, Paul. And you know, like I said, everybody that is doing software development today probably has their own story about how they got started in doing software development, you know, what piqued their interest in doing it, and you know, kind of why they want to keep doing it on a day-to-day basis. When you stop and think about, you know, the types of opportunities that there are in the industry to do software development, it's not always about sitting down and writing the next operating system or writing the next version of Microsoft Word. There are all kinds of different things that you can do as a software developer that are not focused on productivity-based applications. We have, you know, just in the Microsoft environment, we have folks who are software developers in what we call test. And that's what they focus on, is they focus on writing code that tests the code written by software developers for the application. So you might decide that that's what you want to do. You don't really want to sit down and write code for functionality. You want to sit down and write code that tests other people's code to do things. Taking a look at our Microsoft Studios, which I think we've changed the name to 343 Studios now, if I remember correctly. We've got games developers that sit over there. But just looking at developing something like the Halo game, you know, as an example, it involves more than just somebody writing code. We've got graphics design folks. We've got animators. We have folks who deal with, you know, the whole production of it. audio and video and different aspects of the whole game itself. And the programmers are just one aspect of it, but they're the folks who sit down and write the logic for how things happen in the game. You know, if you, as I tell my son, I get incredibly frustrated when I play these first-person shooter games because I'm getting old and my reflexes are slowing down. I say, I know I shot that guy, but he killed me first. Why did that happen? Well, some coder in the background who's developing that Halo game had to determine that I was wrong and he was right because my bullet missed that guy. And the reason being is because they've written that logic that says, you know, if he was aiming at the right position and he was within certain parameters and he squeezed the trigger at this particular point in time, then we call that a hit, right? So these are different things that, you know, the developers focus on is sometimes the logic behind that. So, you know, productivity applications we talked about. We talked about, you know, coding for game development and things like that. Mobile applications, that's a huge market that continues to expand as, you know, more and more people come on board with smartphones and tablets and mobile devices and things like that. So the opportunities to write code for software applications are pretty much almost limitless, and you've got a wide range of things that you can be doing from that perspective. So, you know, you go on to your local career sites and you do searches on programming or software development. You get an idea as to what comes back in terms of job titles, but also read the job descriptions, and those will give you a good idea of what it will be like in the day of a developer, maybe at that specific company only, but those job descriptions lay out what you will be expected to do on a regular basis in that job.
Yeah, and in Module 4, we covered web development, which is a great way to get your feet wet in software development in general. Start out with HTML, see how that works for you, see if you like coding in HTML. You can get instant gratification because you can create a web page and then view it in the browser on your local computer, and that's a great way to figure out whether software development is for you just by trying basic web development. And again, just review Module 4 if you're interested in that type of development.
Yeah, great input. So, now let's take a look at the next section here. We want to talk about, you know, how do I get there from here? So we've provided you with, you know, a fair bit of information over this entire jumpstart. If you've watched it from beginning to end, that talks about software development, that talks about the different aspects of it and what you can expect. And, you know, maybe now you've come to the point where you said, yeah, this is for me, but, you know, where do I go from here? You provided some basic information. I need more. I need to learn more. You talked about this certification exam. What the heck is it? So we've added a few slides here at the end that will kind of help you understand how, really, to get there from here, how to become that software developer from this starting point. So training resources. If you're, again, this MVA, this session was focused on the MTA 98-361 Software Development Fundamentals exam. If you're considering going for that exam, whether you have taken the training in your school, whether you had hoped that what we provided you was enough to pass the exam, which unfortunately it's not because we went over stuff rather quickly, I recommend you go out and use this link that you see at the top for the student study guide. And this study guide was written specifically for that exam, meaning it took a look at what